very fascinating book that talks about this cabal of Bacchanalian fellows, commented the pole was likely Barrymore's pride and joy. In a fundamental sense, it linked the spiritual and the grotesque that Barrymore was deeply interested in. From his eye, that is the eye of Western culture and Western art. Again, seeing that stream all the way from the early Spanish explorers continuing. So here's what his close friend and biographer, Gene Fowler, wrote about, and this is the source of some of the misconceptions. An American settler on Lemassurier Island, which is up in Icy Straits, on the northern part of southeastern Alaska, where Jack acquired a totem pole. It's that particular phrase that I believe began Wayne Howell down his track to look for evidence of its relationship to that region. Told Barrymore, so this American settler, who you'll see in a moment, that to remove such a tribal emblem from its appointed place meant bad luck. During the voyage homeward, Jack became concerned about what the settler had told him. Barrymore said that he halfway believed that the tribal gods, so in this model, those images represent gods, in whose behalf the pole had been erected, might take a notion into their whimsical noggins to wreak vengeance on the thief. So you can see he is self-designating himself as the thief in this particular quotation. Fowler himself was a very, very close friend of Barrymore's over all of his life, so I believe that that was a direct quote that Fowler heard him say that Barrymore said. Ominous conjectures indeed. This is the Icy Strait region, the home of Hunakau or Kwan, and this is a map that Wayne Howell sent me to show the location of the people's house who will look at that Barrymore visited. It's located right here on this island, and Wayne indicates it had previously had a village on it. The shark is a primary crest of the Wushkitan clan, and that this is the location of the Wushkitan tribal house, which also had a screen. And Howell was told by the Hunawushkitan elder Sam Hamlin that a pole with a shark crest had disappeared from the area many years ago. And this is what prompted his investigation and his thought, again, that central feature, that sea creature, was a what? A shark, would link it to the Wushkitan. This is Joe and Muzz Ibeck. These are sort of legendary figures in northern southeastern Alaska. I misspelled Lemassurier, I apologize. These were friends with Barrymore, and he visited them in his yacht on the several occasions when he came north. Barrymore commented that the couple were the only real people he ever met. John wasn't in real good contact with the general public. And the only ones who made him feel like a regular guy, a normal human being. I guess he didn't talk much to the crew around the films either. They play an interesting supporting role in the saga of the Cotilla. So now here's Greg Mank's book, Hollywood's Hellfire Club, and I won't ask you guys all, but they're all those figures that I was talking about before are all represented on the cover of this incredible book. So this is the quote that Mank has. After a sailing adventure to Alaska in 1931, Barrymore brought home a new acquisition, a towering totem pole, and he erected it to loom over Bella Vista. Notice these things loom. They aren't just placed, they have to loom. It's painted grotesque faces leering, okay? So they're not just grotesque, but they're also leering now at anyone visiting the number 6 Tower Road estate. Lionel, his brother, was concerned. There was, John had learned, bodies of Alaska natives entombed in the totem pole, and Lionel Barrymore feared the curse that it threatened to cast down upon the unbowed head of his brother. Years later, he still blamed his brother's spectacular downfall on the totem pole. Barrymore's fate. At the end of his life, Barrymore's excesses, his alimony, and his loss of memory contribute to a downfall from the heights of a previous decade. He died in 1942, dissolute and penniless, despite selling off his acquisitions. He was, as I said, a very excellent artist. And here's a self-representation of himself as King Lear. Seemed most apropos for that time, particular time of his life. Was the curse real? And did the curse descend through other generations, Barrymores, including the one who traveled to Alaska recently? So, Barrymore died in 1942. His estate went up for sale. And subsequently, another family of Hollywood notoriety came to the fore. And this is a man, Vincent Price. Vincent Price might be a little bit more known to people because his life overlaps, and he was quite central to lots of TV. But Price was educated, collegiately educated, and he obtained a degree in fine arts. And he had a very, very well-honed appetite for artistic phenomenon. Wasn't sure what he would do, but ended up in movies. And he went on to a career as the best-known horror actor of his generation in movies and later on TV, hosting various different programs. He was acquainted with Barrymore, and in one of the volumes that I looked at, it's stated that he was one of the pallbearers, but in other listings, he's not noted as a pallbearer for Barrymore. At any rate, I'm sure he had visited Bella Vista and seen the various different objects. When the estate went up for sale, his wife went to the estate sale and discovered that his wife, Mary Price, was also a very wealthy woman. I suspect that's why Vincent married her. But at any rate, she was a patron of arts throughout the world, throughout especially the Pacific region. And so she went to the estate sale and said, "My God, there's a totem pole available. We better get that, Vince." And so Vince went along with the program, and indeed, they acquired the cutia from the Barrymore estate. Not sure exactly when it was transferred to the Price estate. I might be able to find out that probably after 1945, maybe 1946. Here's the picture that originally prompted my interest back in the 1990s in the Ketchikan Museum when I was browsing through the pages and discovered this particular image. And there indeed is Kutia in bold presence. And lo and behold, I looked very closely and I said, "My God, that's Vincent Price." Here, however, Vince has made a little addition. And you'll see this later on. He has changed the configuration of the sea creature by adding in a slot that was there but was emptied when he acquired the pole, his particular interpretation, and it is that picture and that particular interpretation that led various parties to thinking that this was a shark, as opposed to, as we'll see later on, what our present interpretation is. So, Price wrote a book called I Like What I Know, which is quite an interesting book, regaling us with all of his artistic acquisitions, and his collection of which can be found, I think it's probably appropriate, at East Los Angeles Community College is where his collection is housed of all of the objects. But this gives us a little sense of also this notion of grandiosity and represented grandiosity. Some night or some dewy dawn, come over to our house. We'll give you a cup of coffee, and after we've worn you to a frazzle with the whys and wherefores of what we like, we'll let you out by the side door. We don't have to point it out to you. It's hard to miss, a totem pole, 25 feet tall. But there it stands in our backyard for all the world to see. A totem in your backyard, Mr. Price? Of course, doesn't everyone have one? And giving you a sense of how Vincent liked to be thought of in the larger world of his colleagues. And I'd like make a commendation to my brother-in-law, Joe Cooper, who's here today. And when I was telling this story at a family gathering, Joe was sitting there kind of, a totem pole, Vincent Price, Mary, we've got a cookbook by Vincent and Mary Price. And indeed, there it is, a treasure of great recipes. So in addition to their art collections, the Prices were gourmands and purveyors of stylish living to their fans. Friends. And so here we have a treasury of great recipes by Vincent and Mary Price. And indeed, Joe, going back through and leafing through the book, discovered, holy smokes, there's cutia. Cutia is a luncheon piece and providing atmosphere for the prices. And this is what's written in the cookbook. We lunch in our garden. Mary has some favorite props. A wondrous scalloped shell heaped with cracked crab, a bronze Art Nouveau head filled with sourdough rolls, and a towering totem pole from Barrymore's hillside, all glorious aids to happy eating. So we can see the fate of cutia as it becomes positioned in the lives of Hollywood's great and not so great individuals. Mary, as I said, was a patron of the arts. And after her divorce from Vincent, she deeded and transferred cutia to the Hollywood Academy, later to become Museum of Art. Cutia arrived in Honolulu in 1981 or 82 and has resided in the basement of that structure for the past 30 years. This is the expert's report and valuation submitted to the museum at the time of acquisition. This is a very, very well-known Indian art evaluator of the time named Harmer Johnson. What I'm intrigued now by reading this over again is that he already knew that it was from Tuxican. Heretofore, there had been no designation, but Harmer somehow knew that it was from Tuxican. And I don't know if you can see it at the very bottom, but he says the valuation on it at that time, circa 1981, was $90,000. He also noted that he was able to identify painted coloration. So this was had paint, so did not have original ancestral traditional colors, but it, and of course, is then has paints on it that are from the late 19th or around the 20th century. His conservator's report at the time indicates that his notion was that it was a hawk, the human figure holding a killer whale. So he also had the killer whale. And then he also recognized the bear seated at the bottom. He then went on to talk about the characteristics. The piece arrived in three parts. Now, this was the first designation that, in fact, Barrymore had decapitated cutia in two locations when he brought the pole aboard his yacht. He could not possibly have carried that 29 feet long, so he had to decapitate it. And decapitate is the appropriate word, as you will see here momentarily. He talks about the various different problems that have gone on in terms of the loss of the paint, the extensive inhabitation infestation of insects and birds, including woodpeckers who nested in the core area. He suggested a number of different things by which the piece could be renovated and cleaned. So with the exception of one occasion, in which only the top portion of cutia was brought out from the storage, and you can see why my term decapitation is now appropriate. You can see what happened in terms, this is the only time in which there was a public display within the Honolulu Museum, and one might say that it was not perhaps the most respectful representation possible, but then again, the Honolulu Museum of Art did not have a whole lot of heritage in association with North American or Northwest Coast Indian art. Their collections are primarily, as one might expect, from the Pacific. In April of 2013, acting as the representative of the Cooperative Association Tribal Council, I was able to travel to Honolulu and was graciously be received by the director and the curator and taken down into the storage area where I indeed found the cutia in three pieces, in which include two decapitations, the bear decapitation and the human decapitation. These were originally done by Barrymore himself. Here's some of the more up-close pictures that show the way in which cutia has been treated. That, my friends, is cement that was put in there. Iron bolts, and in the back, an iron an iron backbone was placed so that it could be erected on John Barrymore's estate and on subsequently. That's the way in which Price also erected it. There's the decapitated head of the human figure, showing what the conservator says is some of the earliest paint that was put on it. So some work can do to be found on what kind of paint that actually was. It, the, some of it is in pretty obviously good good condition vis-a-vis what has happened to it over the generations. Now we turn to that central sea creature. And the cutia's carving details were important to the consultants in identifying the probable crest of the image. On the right, you can clearly see this is as it appeared on Price, and that clearly is an insert, a totally different kind of wood that has been inserted, and it's taking on a particular characteristic that it was not carved by a Tlingit person, a Tlingit carver, and so therefore it was not done in any fashion appropriate to the piece. The two other pictures at the top, you see the face of the creature, and of particular interest to the several consultants was what is referred to in Tlingit art nomenclature as the slash above the nose right here. And this slash is interpreted as the flow of foam across across the face of an animal as it comes out of the water, as the foam goes across. And that is particularly characteristic, according to the consultants, of the manner in which killer whales are. And secondly, at the bottom, this representation of a flipper, as opposed to the gills or the shark, is what allowed them to say this is either a killer whale, a small killer whale, or possibly a pilot whale, and not a shark. So, cutia in the eyes and lives of Barrymore and Price. For Barrymore, cutia represents extravagant display, grotesque and ghoulish figures to his Western-trained eye for art representing spiritual powers unknown. Is taken as an example of arrogance of the age. No attempt was ever made, that is apparent, to contact relevant parties, acquire information, or seek out rightful owners. To Price, trained in art, and a man on the leading edge of encountering primitive art, he acquired an admirable collection, but always viewed it through the lenses of this word called art. And I want to juxtapose that back to what I told you about the way in which this object functions in this culture. It doesn't stand as a material object. It has a living presence, it has living purposes, it has living relationships with those who have come to engage with it. And he had no sense of origination and purpose, no curiosity about what particular context it might have come from. It was a luncheon aid, I guess. Neither owner made any effort that I cannot find to understand its cultural origins or role in the culture of the creators. The museum thought the piece was from British Columbia during NAGPRA process and never informed the Kowak tribe of its presence, even though it had been identified as a Tlingit carving from Tuxacan in their own records. Harmer Johnson's record was given to me in which he clearly stated that. So that's a very unfortunate circumstance. So what is cutia's future? A number of possibilities are being examined by the tribe and the museum from its return in its place in the manner in which it presently is seen to a recarving. And the Kowak tribe has undertaken in the past 20 years the project of recarving many of the poles that originally came from Tuxacan, not ones. This would be represent the first one that actually was removed from Tuxacan. The ones that have been recreated to date were actually ones that were still in place in the 1930s, when under the aegis of the Civilian Conservation Corps, they were brought down to Kowak, and in the process, copies were made, and John Rowan is now engaging in the second generation of recreating those particular forms. So that represents one of the kinds of things that, from the vantage point of the Kowak tribe, are being considered. The Honolulu Museum has been very willing to share and convey information and is willing to listen to proposals. They don't see any particular reason for the pole to continue, for Cutia to continue to be housed there, but the conditions under which they would see to its return remain to be negotiated. The Cooperative Association is aware of its existence and considering what to do. The Tlingit people do want Cutia to return to its homeland. Thank you all for listening to my presentation, and I'd be happy to take questions for in a moment. Oh, yeah.
Do you have a question?
Yeah. When a totem is retired, how is that done?
Well, John, well, this is a matter of some discussion, but in at least one case, the idea was that the poles, as living beings, will live their lives and die. And so the act of keeping them is not necessarily in keeping with the traditional ideas. This happened, for example, when a Hina leader, Dennis Demmert, collected a number of poles from the southern region of the Tongass Islands. And there was a lot of discussion about whether or not that should be done. At the present time, the poles that he collected are housed. The ones that were not recarved are housed under a building there. And the ones that John Rowan has recarved are placed respectfully by the side of the building. And so they are allowed to return through the processes of general natural processes. They will break down and go back. So that's why, rather than trying to shore up with cement, the recarving option is the one that appeals to them most at this particular time.
So there's no kind of specific ceremony for retiring a totem?
No. Yeah.
What I know a little bit about totem pole because of my friend Carter. And sometimes a totem pole was taken and gingerly lowered to the ground and laid to rest on the ground. And if it was a special totem pole, you know, if it was a mortuary pole that once housed the remains of a human being, then sometimes they would commission another artist to carve a replica of that totem pole. But the artist was always allowed his own interpretation of the pole on how the clan lineage was placed on the pole. And once the commemorative pole was carved to replace the mortuary pole, then the mortuary poles were set aside so that it could decay naturally.
Yeah.
You know, and this would, you know, this was part of the last cycle of our grieving process. And then once the commemorative pole was carved, a story was created to go with it, to honor the memories of the ones that were buried inside the pole. You know, that's some of the understanding that I gained.
Thank you for sharing that. Yes, indeed.
Am I right in thinking that they had a big ceremony down in Sitka at the Totem Park there? Was it a year ago or 2 years ago when there was a famous totem which had decayed and deteriorated but which was still in place? But then they made like a replica of it to go
yes.
in the totem park in Sitka and in fact invited people in to see it when it was being carved
yes.
and there were wonderful ceremonies.
Yeah. And the reason why they would take them down is it was a matter of practicality as well as spiritual. You know, they would take the totem pole down once they reached a point where they couldn't stand on their own. You know, and they revered them and recognized them as an elder pole, you know, unable to support itself. So they would lay it on the ground, and they would allow it to finish its decay. You know, but if it was a special pole, they always hired and commissioned another artist to carve a replica of the pole. To interpret the clan crest as closely as they can, but they were still given the freedom to add their own interpretations to it. And usually when a replica pole was made, it was never made exactly the same. They would add special marks to it, indicating that this part of the process is carrying on that same story.
Yes.
Yeah. You mentioned something about the compartment where the remains were, and I thought there was something that happened later with that. Is that where the fin was put in?
No.
Can you repeat the question?
I'm sorry?
Can you repeat the question?
The question was the mentioning of what, if the remains were in a box, where would they be located, and were they located in that place where the fin was put? No. The standard practice would be to have a niche carved in the back of the pole, and the box, the skeletal remains would be positioned in that location. Now, that may have been the case with this pole, and this may be revealed in some diaries and logs later on. But the specific reference by Lionel to his understanding, and he's in close discussion with his brother, it may represent a comment that John made that, in fact, he knew that there had been bones, or he became aware of the bones as the pole was being taken. But we don't have any, what I would say, conclusive evidence with regard to that at this point, unless the logs of the vessel or a diary, and his wife had a diary, have some more information on that. We can't make a, I would make a conclusive determination about that. Question over there?
Yeah, why did the museum think the pole was from British Columbia? Was that just being lazy?
Yeah, that bureaucratic ineptitude, not going back and finding the file where Johnson said where it was from. And it probably turned over, NAGPRA files turned over to Stafford. Go check this out. Somebody who's not particularly acquainted might have been the one, and that's from the name that I looked on of that particular situation.
Just a wild, wild guess.
Yeah, sure.
Well, I wanted to comment on the fact that the totems were hollowed out usually, and when it's a burial pole, and I've seen a lot of those growing up, that they would hollow it out to a certain level, and then there would be like a shelf.
Yeah.
And that's where the bomb was. It wasn't like they carved the totem in ground, and then they just carved the hole in the back.
The whole thing is
hollow, and that's the way totems were made. Mm-hmm. And then there's that shelf. Also, the totems, once it served its purpose, it wasn't a practice to remake the same pole.
Right.
Because it was carved for a certain purpose, to tell a certain thing.
Yeah.
So when it got too old, the people would get worried that it might fall over.
Mm-hmm.
And hurt somebody. Then there was a ceremony to put it down, and it was treated like a person who died.
Yes.
To be taken over.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't allowed to touch the ground, so it was a big ceremony that they used for the ground.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for sharing. Sure. Yes. Yeah.
Did you say that it looked like it had been cut in thirds rather than put on deck as one piece? I mean, when you saw, did you see where the seams were, how they might have been
different? Yeah, there's various different techniques. They put a, they use that back thing to bind it all together, but there's some, like a disc in your spine, they inserted between the two to reposition them back together. And then that was fused to this new backbone that was created in order to give it that erect stance.
You've got metal scaffolding on the back, didn't
you? Yeah, later on. Yes?
I don't know anymore how to designate you, yeah.
Not a body. These are the skeletal remains following cremation. They would be placed in a box, and on the back side of the pole, as Mrs. Kendall had said, pole is hollowed out and a shelf remains, not down, and then the box is positioned on the back side of the pole, not where you can see it, but in the behind of the pole is where the box with the remains would be located.
When you observed them.
They hollowed out the entire back area to put that metal piece in. and two of them were laid down. I couldn't look, and the one, the only one that I could look in the back on the bear pole, it had this metal piece right up. There was no way. So it has been, I would say, unless there's some really expert eye there that can discern, it's been modified to the point where you couldn't make that discernment anymore.
Was there any reference as to who, what person or what party or what family?
No, there's no oral tradition in regard to that particular pole or many other poles from that community as well. Yes? Someone else have a question? Yeah, go ahead, sure.
If they pinpointed that he got the pole in May, he must have known from the previous visits that everybody would be gone in May. That's when everybody would have to go to the fish camps. If he got the pole in May, I think that was if from previous visits he would know that the village would be empty because everybody would go to the fish camp and there wouldn't be anybody there to protest him taking that pole. So I kind of thought about that and I realized that if they know it was May, then that was a time when nobody was there.
Well, the village was, as I said, basically depopulated between 1906 and 1910. They all moved to Kowak. However, your point is well taken, is that they do pass by during the fishing season. The commercial salmon season, the fishermen would go back by and fish in the streams, and they would look at the village. In fact, that's how later in the 1930s, another object was taken from Touchdown, which was a great dogfish, the 1080 Raven dogfish screen was taken. And that was recently repatriated to the community from the National Museum of the American Indian. So this community had lots of art that served lots of purposes, mostly not for themselves, as you can see, for others in these particular cases. Yes?
Is it possible there were people there and he just didn't care?
May of 1931, it's unlikely. They could have been out there at a camp for king salmon trolling, but that would have been done more to the west out towards the ocean. And they maybe have been passing around, but unless we see a log or a diary, we won't know the specific dates and other sorts of possible comments. They may have been too anxious because he self-designates himself as a thief. And when call yourself a thief, that means that you're not, you know you're taking something that belongs to someone else.
Have you seen other poles in other museums?
No. No, most poles aren't decapitated. Thankfully.
Any idea about the other pole that was missing from glaciers or icy straits?
No idea about that at this point in time, whether that'll be located or not. I don't know. Oh, yes.
Do you know if the plan is if this pole is returned, if they'll be able to replicate the pole and then...
I believe that's what John would like to do. Oh, we've had some discussions around that, identifying the appropriate log, and obtaining it from Sea Alaska to get that done. That's his anticipation, is he wants to move in that direction of now that he's recarved all of the ones that they got, and he'd like to start recarving the ones that were taken from images or from other kinds of things and bring them back home in that sense as well. Yes?
I had one quick question about Barrymore's worry about a curse following down. I don't know, I'm sure everybody here probably does, when the Tut tomb was open and there was a lot of worry about the curse of that it might be more likely that he really felt there would have been bones in that totem at one point.
Once he heard about that possibility, that I'm sure heightened his anxieties. But remember, when he was first told by Eibach, his first impression was that the images stood for gods. And given his notion of supernatural powers, he was concerned about supernatural powers from these foreign gods. Later, Lionel's is the one who references the bones, and I think that still comes from the context of the exchange, but at what point he became aware of that, Eibach may have told him about that as well, but we don't have sufficient information to know whether he was informed of that. When he cruised up in front of Blemisher Island with three sections of totem pole attached to his boat, and came ashore to visit his old buddy, who was aghast, I'm sure. What have you done? Kind of deal there. Yes?
Do you have a time frame with the Honolulu Museum returning it, or the Lincolns?
Well, the next stage is to negotiate the issues with regard to what they're willing to let the pole be returned to. This extraordinary 40-foot wide crest artwork, the house front that was returned by the American Indian in that last summer, it was taken by in 1938 or 1939, and that was returned without concern, although I'm concerned and the people are concerned. In other words, the question from a museum that usually is dealt with in regard to this is, what is the nature of the conservation environment in which the object is going to be returned? And whether or not that's the case, that the American Museum of Natural History did not utilize those constraints. I don't know if there are standards. Natural standards don't require that. Yeah, Aaron, you want to come?
I was going to say that. There's nothing about that.
No. So they don't want to receive a NAGPRA claim.
That's up to the community about the return of the museum, and I would imagine the U.S. Museum, that they would be actually, it's not their choice, they would be bound by the
on request. Yeah. Well, they kind of want to finesse that, it appears, so I'm not sure what's going to happen there. Okay, well, oh, go ahead, Dave.
It kind of bogs my mind that a man would walk right into a totem pole and take it. I think there's more to it than that. I think somebody made the money off of it. I know, being a Tlingit myself, we go through that system all the time where I come from. I think there's got to be more to it than or going in there with a chainsaw or whatever, helping himself do it without somebody's permission.
That's an interesting idea. Certainly that position, that person wouldn't have wanted to stand up and say in any moment in history that that's what they agreed to. But I know exactly what you have dealt with, the cultural patrimony of your village coming into those particular circumstances in which people certainly are seduced by lucre in those circumstances. The house front that was taken, that dog salmon house front, there's no evidence the owner of that house front, when Dennis Demmert's uncle, who was fishing in that area, used to come and watch that house front, said that he came by it in 1940 to look for it and it was gone. Now, whether that's a true and accurate statement, I believe it's a true statement. It was taken by one of George Emmons' assistants and turned over to the American Museum of Natural History, where it was housed for many, many decades. So. Well, thank you all. I appreciate you coming and listening to my presentation. Thanks so much.